Within 20 years of World War I, Germany, under her leader Adolf Hitler, was revitalized, rearmed, and determined on expansion with its savage prelude, war. Since 1918, the keenest military minds had undertaken a searching analysis of the Great War and reached a radical decision that would change the face of Europe. In a modern war, Germany was determined never again to be brought to her knees by a long, drawn-out blockade. It was unthinkable that the horrors of the trenches should ever be repeated, so campaigns would need to be swift and decisive. In 1939, Germany's rearmament was still far from complete. But if Hitler delayed his plans any longer, Germany's enemies might then be too strong for her. To be successful, he needed easy, quick, and decisive victories. It was here that the ideas of General Heinz Guderian came to appear increasingly attractive. A man of acute and perceptive intelligence, he had devoted much thought to the question of how tanks might best be used in battle. Plans and tactics were tried out in war games and maneuvers, which soon convinced Germany's dictator that he had discovered the way to make his dream become a reality. On the 1st of September 1939, the German cruiser Holstein, on a goodwill visit to Poland, lay at anchor in Danzig harbor. Giving no warning, she opened fire with her heavy guns. Hitler was about to plunge Europe into years of barbarity and turmoil on an unprecedented scale, made possible by the brilliant application of a new, devastating war tactic, Blitzkrieg. Blitzkrieg evolved from a reassessment of war tactics that took place not only in Germany, but in Russia and Britain as well. Two perceptive British military theorists, Major General J.C. Fuller and Captain B. Liddell Hart, understood that the introduction of the tank during World War I had opened up hitherto undreamt of military possibilities.
There are quite a lot of claimants as to who wishes to be, if you like, the father of the Blitzkrieg. It's generally accepted that Liddell Hart and Fuller, the experiments with the British tank, were important. But really, it's only fair to mention at the same time that A, the Germans themselves had worked on this very considerably. In other words, their problem, indeed it was the general problem, which was the application of motorization and the new weaponry to the problems of the breakthrough. That's the first point. And the second thing is that in spite of the theoretical writings of Liddell Hart and the limited experiments of General Fuller, the Reichswehr, the German army, had been collaborating with the Russians secretly during the 1920s and the early part of the 1930s. And it was there in Russia, and certainly not in England or in Great Britain, that the Germans saw, for example, for the first time, the organization of the first large-scale mechanized brigade, then a mechanized division, and finally a mechanized corps.
Although the Polish campaign was predominantly a conventional war, the German battle plan did include some elements of Blitzkrieg. Hitler made no declaration of war, for example, a fact which, unbelievably, caught his victims off guard every time it occurred during the war, and which gave him the vital advantage of surprise. Attacks by the Luftwaffe preceded the invasion. Screaming over Poland ahead of the main armies, their task was to destroy the Polish Air Force and then to act as airborne artillery for the ground forces. Spreading terror among the civilians was also an important part of their mission. The attempt to destroy the Polish Air Force on the ground was only partially successful, since many of their warplanes were at new locations. Nonetheless, air superiority was quickly established, and by day three, the Polish Air Force had been virtually annihilated. From the start, the Germans engaged in innovative warfare. At vital stages during the attack, Stukas hurtled earthwards to place their bombs almost to within centimeters of the center of their targets. Coordination between the Air Force, the motorized and armored formations was exemplary, providing enormous flexibility, especially in the absence of artillery support. When Hitler visited the tank corps soon after the invasion, it was the destruction that the panzer divisions had caused which astonished him most. Guderian had lost only 150 men and 700 wounded. The Blitzkrieg elements were falling smoothly into place. By far the greater part of both armies in 1939 was of traditional composition. While the Germans made highly effective use of available railways and of their limited number of air transports, their forces remained enormously dependent on horsepower.
What people always fail to remember is, in fact, that the German army in 1939, indeed the entire German armed forces, were hardly as mechanized as one would suppose an army today to be. Much of the logistics was horse-drawn. This had an interesting impact on the Luftwaffe, the German Air Force. They could range far and wide, but whenever they had to move their bases forward, much of their supplies, including the fuel for the aircraft, had to come in by horse. The result is that the pace of their ability to move their operations eastward was much diminished.
The elite of the old-fashioned Polish army was considered to be the mounted cavalry. Galloping fearlessly across the battlefield, like ghosts from a lost age, desperate cavalrymen were committed to the ludicrous activity of charging the German tanks with their lances and sabers. The attitudes and methods of the Polish High Command were no less outmoded. Endeavoring to hold a thin and overextended front of 2,000 kilometers, the Poles fought with selfless bravery. But against the matchless military efficiency of the invaders, such victories were short-lived.
I think the Poles were overwhelmed. They were still fighting a 19th century war or a First World War with cavalry, whereas the German military commanders, essentially because they were quite young, remember the German army had been rebuilt, and that meant that a lot of the line commanders were young guys who wanted to try out new ideas, also true in the Air Force. So they didn't have the same kind of preconceptions about how to fight the war. I think right through to 42, 43, that's what gives the Germans their edge. And it's only when in the Allies and the Americans and the later British forces come along with a new generation of officers that they're able to match idea for idea.
Although brilliantly conceived and executed, the overall German strategy was still based on the classic German tradition of encirclement and envelopment, carried out mainly by conventional forces. By the 17th of September, Poland's situation was beyond hope. Stalin had been unpleasantly surprised by the speed of the German advance. Even with the supposed security of a non-aggression pact with Hitler in his pocket, Stalin did not want to see Germany control the whole of Poland. That day, he announced that the Polish state had ceased to exist. The Red Army then moved in from the east to claim its share of the spoils.
The most significant invasion wasn't the German attack on Poland, it was the Soviet invasion of Poland. Because the Red Army came in from the east and the German army had come in from the west, and basically the Polish army was trapped and forced into surrender. I wouldn't say there was a significant engagement in the Polish campaign. What was really important was the Germans actually managed to complete their encirclement. It was a very large-scale encirclement. And from that point of view, I think looking at the Polish campaign, one would say that the Blitzkrieg technique in principle worked. But even more important, the element of large-scale encirclement also worked.
As Stalin made his announcement, Warsaw was surrounded and the Germans demanded its surrender. The Poles refused. A pitiless air raid on Warsaw helped to force them to a bitter but inevitable capitulation. By the 3rd of October, it was all over. 13 million Poles were now Stalin's subjects. 20 million belonged to Hitler.
What we now understand as the classic form of the Blitzkrieg was unleashed against Poland in September 1939. It consisted of 26 German infantry divisions and 6 panzer divisions and 4 light divisions and 4 motorized divisions. And that was, if you like, a component of the Blitzkrieg element which was to be used. The most important part of this, which became, if you like, par for the course, was, of course, the use of the Luftwaffe in the initial stages of the attack. What the Luftwaffe did was to pound the Polish defences. It was to destroy the Polish air force and, even more important, interfered with Polish mobilisation. So the air-ground component, which became a classic element of the Blitzkrieg technique, was first unleashed in Poland.
In Germany, there was jubilation and a sense of restored national pride. The nation's virile leader acquired new prestige and laurels from the fatherland, and the Third Reich sensed that it was entering into a glorious new world of its own making. Among Germany's enemies, there reigned dismay and apprehension. Their disquiet was well-founded. Yet the next display of German military speed, codenamed Exercise Weser, was caused by the tardiness of the British themselves.
It's safe to say that Norway would have been invaded one way or the other, either by the British or by the Germans. And in fact, the Germans merely got their retaliation in early. To such an extent, the Germans really weren't prepared particularly for the Norwegian adventure. They had very poor logistics. They had to commandeer all sorts of inadequate aircraft in order to fly troops in. And the Norwegians indeed put up a very stiff resistance. So I think actually the outcome of the Norwegian campaign is much more in the balance than it seemed in retrospect.
Norway and Denmark were both neutral countries. Their strategic importance became crystal clear, however, when Hitler realized that Germany's supplies of iron ore from Sweden could easily be severed by an Allied force. On the 7th of April, German forces launched their invasion of Denmark and Norway by land, sea, and air to grant those countries the euphemistically phrased protection of the Third Reich. The Wehrmacht swept over the border into Denmark, and as troops landed at Copenhagen, the Luftwaffe circled ominously overhead. Denmark had no choice but to accept an ultimatum and surrendered early on the 9th of April to its mighty neighbour.
The Norwegian campaign wasn't a blitzkrieg in the classic sense. What the Norwegian campaign was a combination of airborne operations and naval operations. Yes, the German ground forces were used, but precisely because of the terrain, precisely because of the fact the Norwegians only had 15,300 men in their army, so it was no contest, if I may say so. I think you can only regard that as a blitz operation in the sense, yes, you had the use of airborne forces and the very considerable use of the air element. But the nature of the terrain, I mean, Norway itself, was not to be compared, for example, with the flat open plains of Poland.
Norway had last seen a war in 1814 and was totally unprepared for the invasion. 14 destroyers, protected by the Scharnhorst and the Gneisenau, transported mountain troops to Trondheim and Narvik, where they were landed by amphibious craft, and similar landings took place at Oslo, Kristiansand, and Bergen. Once again, the speed of German activity had rendered the leaden plans of her enemies ineffective. On land, the Germans were organizing and advancing with startling efficiency and rapidity. They also enjoyed absolute air supremacy, and their troops were highly trained and excellently equipped. By the evening of the 9th of April, all major cities, ports, and airfields were in German hands. The door to Scandinavia was now slammed in Britain's face, and, buoyed with success, the Führer confidently focused on a more glorious prize than any he had yet attained, France. France was Germany's ancient enemy and had been her humiliator at Versailles. Hitler initiated planning for Fall Gelb, Case Yellow.
The campaign in the West got off to a very curious start. I think it's also fair to say that, in a sense, it really wasn't planned as a blitzkrieg. What the Allied commanders expected, and in a sense what the Germans had planned for, was a repeat of the 1914 Schlieffen plan. In other words, what would happen is the German army would come in from the north through Belgium, and then there would be a classic breakthrough battle fought, and it might well have developed on the lines of something like the 1914 war. But what happened in January 1940, while this campaign was being planned, was a German aircraft was shot down over Belgium. And what the Allies discovered were the air operational plans for this attack. And that was only part of the operation. In other words, this was the attack which would come through the north. And so we were, in a sense, our suspicions were confirmed, but the Allies were also misled. The second thing after this happened, Hitler then decided to have second thoughts. And there was a great consideration of the nature and course of Case Yellow.
Case Yellow was repeatedly postponed. The delay was put to good use, for an intensive study of the Polish campaign was undertaken. The role of the armored divisions and the other Blitzkrieg components came under particular scrutiny. One of the men eager to discover what improvements could be introduced was Heinz Guderian, one of Hitler's most capable generals. During the Great War, Guderian had worked extensively with wireless and gained invaluable experience in the deployment of infantry, artillery, and aircraft. He had a clear vision of the force he wished to create. His tanks would be concentrated in armored divisions, not dispersed in small numbers. They would be spearheads of a single, large military formation, also comprising aircraft, artillery, and mechanized infantry. The commander would not be stationed far in the rear, but would operate near the front, responding instantly to changing situations and issuing orders by wireless directly to his units. Making the most efficient use possible of available technology was only part of Guderian's work. He also had a clear understanding of the value of proper training and that it was vital to encourage drive and initiative even in the lowest ranks. The German army as a whole had incomparable standards. The men of the tank arm were trained to an even higher pitch.
German tanks were very good in the sense of the engineering and the engines, but they had very small guns. It took quite a while before both sides realized that you could put quite heavy artillery on a chassis and send it into battle. In fact, the German tanks early on in the war, in 39 and up till the Battle of France, carried very small caliber cannon and light machine guns. They were essentially just an armored reconnaissance force which forced its way through the opposing troops. And it was the guys with the guns coming out behind who did the business.
By the early months of 1940, Guderian was moving steadily closer to realizing his ideal of a highly mobile, integrated striking force. In Poland, the tanks had rarely driven more than 10 miles a day. Now, Guderian disposed of larger, far more modern forces to be used in the first full-scale experiment in Blitzkrieg tactics. Early in the morning of the 10th of May, 1940, Fall Gelb was activated. German forces swung down into the Low Countries, and the term Blitzkrieg, a synonym for terror and death, was burned into the pages of history.
The French had actually a preponderance of military material. The French Air Force was bigger than the German Air Force, and had they properly deployed it, I think that they could have blunted the German invasion sufficiently for the Germans to run out of fuel. I mean, the German backup to that first Blitzkrieg thrust was pretty limited. If they'd managed to be held for a sufficient number of weeks, then they would have run out of fuel and materiel, and we might have been back to something like World War I.
The strategy that had eventually been settled upon for the attack was of glittering audacity. A surprise offensive was launched through Holland and Belgium, which it was hoped would draw the Allied forces northwards, away from their entrenched defensive positions in France. Then a powerful concentration of German armor crashed through the weakly defended Ardennes region. Without real opposition, This arm of the attack would thrust into France to tear the Allied armies in half. Anxiously hoping to the last to propitiate Hitler, Holland and Belgium had refused to allow any Allied troops to be stationed in their territories. Once it was clear that a major assault really was in progress, the Allied commander-in-chief ordered his forces northwards to take up positions on the line of the River Dyle. The Luftwaffe unleashed devastating bombing raids on key targets in Holland, flying in from the sea to deceive the Dutch Air Force. North and south of The Hague, paratroopers landed, whilst panzer divisions raced across the borders. The paratroopers were relatively few in number. Their main objective was to persuade the Allies to pull away from the Ardennes. A ploy could not have worked better. As with the Norwegians, the Dutch had not fought a war for more than a century. On the first day, they had lost most of their airfields and 62 of 125 aircraft. Belgium fared even worse than Holland. The garrison of the so-called impregnable Fort Eben-Emael was still dormant when German gliders silently landed in their midst. Combat engineers dropped charges into 14 gun barrels and disabled them, whilst machine gun fire kept the defenders at bay until the motorized divisions arrived. The great stratagem was working immaculately, and it was reported that when Hitler was told, he almost wept for joy. To the south, the seven armored German divisions leading the principal offensive were feeling their way through the Ardennes. Believing a passage to be impossible here, and relying on the massive fortifications of the Maginot Line, the French had largely neglected this region, and the Germans had to contend with little more than a bemused Belgian horse soldier peering uncomprehendingly through the trees. Although French airmen observed the German movement, their reports were ignored. So the vast assemblage edged on unhampered toward the River Meuse and France.
The Maginot Line was not quite as stupid an idea as people have made out in retrospect, because had there been a central armoured thrust against it, it might have been difficult to break through. The whole point of the German Blitzkrieg is it went round the side, and it was more a matter of the stupidity of the politics of not actually building round the side that got in the way of the success of the Maginot Line.
The River Meuse was the one great obstacle confronting the invaders. It was reached on the morning of May the 13th. Despite skirmishes, the defenders still remained in ignorance of the scale of the impending onslaught. Away to the north, a large clash of French and German armor confirmed the Allied command in their mistaken analysis of German intentions. The Meuse was to be crossed at three points. Exploiting German air superiority, the defenders at Sedan were subjected to an intensive bombardment lasting 6 hours. It was a murderous onslaught, and Guderian's engineers crossed the river swiftly afterwards, followed by the 1st Infantry. By evening, the Germans had smashed their way across and were on the other side in strength, having at last broken the shattered French forces. The two other crossings had also been successfully forced, a crippling blow to the whole Allied defense. In front of the Germans lay long stretches of ideal tank country, held mainly by poorly trained, ill-equipped and elderly reservists. The flying artillery of the dive bombers was already at work, wreaking wholesale destruction, inspiring widespread terror. Behind the spearheads, extending back from the Meuse nearly to the Rhine itself, crowded the 25 divisions of the supporting infantry. That same day, May the 15th, 1940, Holland surrendered. On the following day, as the breach ripped in the southern French defenses widened dramatically, it was belatedly apparent to the Allied command that a potential catastrophe was in the making. The slow, clumsy bombers sent against German targets were sharply repulsed. The armies, attempting to make a hasty retreat from the lowlands, found the roads choked with panic-stricken refugees. For transmission of orders and reports, the Allied command relied heavily on dispatch riders and on the telephone network. Except that now, neither could be relied upon. In the aftermath of invasion, hundreds of French aircraft had been hurriedly removed to safe locations. Now, no one could find them. The skies were becoming the unchallenged domain of the Luftwaffe.
Early on in the war, the ability to drop a bomb directly onto target, if you were very far away from the target, was limited. Now, the Stuka, the J-87, though it was an old rattling thing that went very, very slowly, could barely do more than 100 miles an hour, the point was it got the guy to just over the target where he could put the bomb right down the plug hole. So the dive bomber, the bomber that went right down on its target, was ultra accurate for its time. And that's the issue in terms of cutting edge technology. The Germans had it, whereas the British and the French were very much behind when it came to dive bombing. And their accuracy of their bombs early on in the war was very poor.
In many Allied units, morale and discipline were evaporating. The twin German spearheads thrust on, piercing deeper into France. Guderian's amazing sweep from the Meuse to the sea exemplified Blitzkrieg in its purest and most lethally efficient form. Urged on by their impetuous commander and to the increasing alarm of some of his superiors, his tanks drove onward to the coast, frequently covering 50 miles a day and far outstripping the supporting infantry. Often the mere sight and sound of the thundering tanks was sufficient to disperse any opposition. The disaster at Sedan caused consternation among the French high command. Astute French officers had read correctly the lessons of Poland. Tragically, their generals suffered from the military equivalent of dyslexia and blithely ignored them. New technology had been accepted only grudgingly, new ideas never. In the long, cumbrous chains of command, it could easily take 2 days for an order to reach the front, by which time the battle situation was usually completely transformed. Guderian's tanks drove relentlessly on. All over France, wild rumors abounded. Rumors of fifth columnists and saboteurs, of bizarrely disguised German paratroopers, of imminent new disasters. The already prevalent mood of defeatism deepened further. Yet the French had more troops than the Germans, and a superiority in nearly all types of armaments. They even had more tanks than the Germans. The best of them, such as the heavily armed Chars and Saumurs, were formidable vehicles of war. What was missing was the will and the intelligence to use all these. It would have required an impossibly drastic shift in the thinking of 50 years. Quarrels between French and British, inter-service rivalries, and other dangerous pettiness combined further to make an effective military response impossible.
It was a very successful Blitz campaign. Yes, they broke through in the south. They were able to bring great pressure on the Allied armies. They forced the withdrawal of the British expeditionary force to Dunkirk. They encircled the French armies. So from that point of view, it was a success. And it was a success for two reasons. A, it was very carefully planned and brilliantly executed. But there, the logistics problem was not so serious. Where the German army came up against logistics problem, as it did in Russia, then the Blitzkrieg didn't work. It was what it was meant to be, a short, sharp, rapid, brutal penetration, followed by a flowing out and the disorganization of the enemy command and defenses.
On May the 20th, Guderian reached Amiens. The last link between the Allied forces to the north and south was severed, adding still further to the already dire confusion in the chain of command. On the 24th, Hitler issued one of the most controversial orders of the war. For 2 days, the tanks were halted. This respite prevented a massacre taking place during the subsequent evacuation of the BEF from Dunkirk. France now faced the mighty German forces alone. They were unable to hold back the ineluctable tide of men and weapons.
Militarily, the French still had quite significant forces. Their entire air force was still intact. And indeed, by the last days of the war, the French Air Force was beginning to find its feet in terms of tactics, the ability to marshal large numbers of its fighters and concentrate them against the Germans. But in the end, the generals and the politicians didn't want to fight, and so they surrendered largely with an army intact, particularly its armoured forces and its aircraft and its bombers.
By June the 10th, with the Germans outside the French capital, the government abandoned Paris. Widespread fighting continued, but there was no place for illusions. A full-scale rout was taking place. On the 20th of June, after just 6 weeks of war, France agreed to sign a demeaning armistice. Hitler was overjoyed at this astounding vindication of the methods of Blitzkrieg. Germany rejoiced with him, and with the glorious euphoria of victory mingled a deeper, more human emotion. For the war was surely over. The nation's honor had been restored, German prosperity assured by the new order in Europe. The ignominy of Versailles was lost in the past. Under their revered leader, this transformation had been achieved at a cost far below all expectation. Germany had every reason to thank its armed forces, as this poster exhorted them to do. Hitler was pleased, but not content. In August 1940, German divisions began transferring to Poland to reinforce the attenuated frontier defenses. For the rest of the year, the build-up on the Eastern Front continued unabated, with the forces frequently regrouped to conceal their numbers. With the new year arose an unexpected opportunity for the Blitzkrieg forces to test their expertise once more. Mussolini launched an ill-advised, ill-fated campaign in Greece, which left Italian forces floundering. Early in 1941, he turned to his ally Hitler for help. Realizing that their success in repelling the Italians was likely to bring German vengeance down upon them, the Greeks appealed to their allies, the British, for troops. Their reinforcements proved woefully inadequate. A declaration of war against Yugoslavia and Greece simultaneously was the signal that Blitzkrieg was about to be unleashed again. It burst over Yugoslavia on the 6th of April. The same day, Belgrade was heavily bombed and the Germans tore through the country. Zagreb, Sarajevo, and Skopje fell in quick succession, and just 12 days later, Yugoslavia was occupied. Greece was now the front line. Two German corps had stormed into northern Greece from Bulgaria on the 6th of April, followed on the 8th by the 2nd Panzer Division. Blitzkrieg was once again proving to be unstoppable as the invading armies drove toward the south with the British retreating before them. On the 19th, they had been overwhelmed and evacuated to Crete. They were hardly given time to draw breath. On the 20th of May, the skies over Crete were suddenly filled with German aircraft of Operation Merkur. A relentless bombing raid on the island was the prelude to the first major airborne assault in history. An awesome sight met the eyes of the defenders as the departing aircraft left a cascade of parachutes behind them and the 7th Flieger Division dropped earthwards. What followed was due to the greatest failure of German intelligence up to that point in the war. The British were ready for the paratroopers, and 50% of them were dead before they reached the ground. The carnage was no help to the British, and was almost an irrelevance in the great Blitzkrieg push. 8 days later, the British were being evacuated once more, and Germany seemed invincible. The succession of victories was unbroken, and thus far, German casualties overall had been comparatively small, so that the nation had scarcely felt itself to be at war. People were still full of wonder and admiration. Only a handful of the highest commanders were privy to the extraordinary cataclysm which was to come. Hitler had resolved to invade the Soviet Union. The Balkan flank now secured, the unprecedented military buildup in progress all along Germany's eastern borders continued. This great offensive, codenamed Barbarossa, had been fermenting for a long time in Hitler's mind. Firmly rooted in National Socialist ideology was the conviction that Germany's destiny lay in the East. Once more, Hitler needed a quick war. Once more, he needed it soon. It was his instinct that Germany would never stand so strong as she stood then. And if he delayed, even 1 year, the crowds that cheered so fervently might no longer be willing to follow him into so hazardous an adventure. At last, at 03 hours on the morning of the 22nd of June 1941, the code word, Dortmund, crackled down the wires. 3 million men stood in battle readiness. The ground along the Russian borders vibrated to the thunder of massed artillery. High above, hundreds of bombers flew steadily eastwards. The theory of Blitzkrieg was about to be tested on a far grander scale than anything yet undertaken, and in an arena of frighteningly vast proportions. The German forces were disposed in three great army groups. The topmost swung away northwards, aiming eventually for Leningrad. Another moved sharply down towards the Ukraine. Guderian was with the principal German offensive in Army Group Center. Their objectives were Smolensk, and beyond that, the heart of Russia, Moscow. The invasion forces scythed through hopelessly disorganized opposition and moved rapidly onward. Well honed, the Blitzkrieg pattern was being repeated, and the Soviet defenses whirled away like chaff in the wind. The number of prisoners taken seemed too immense to be true, but it was, and the scale of destruction was terrifying. As the news of Barbarossa reverberated around a stunned and disbelieving world, even Germany was awestruck. Guderian, who still held relatively junior rank, had been appalled. Nevertheless, though full of apprehension, he had set himself to do all within his power. He was acutely aware that the one guiding principle of Blitzkrieg, the concentration of maximum force against a single objective, had already been neglected. Also, as the army groups advanced, they would diverge further away from one another instead of coming closer. Moreover, Guderian was not being allowed to develop the technique he had exploited so masterfully in France.
The Polish campaign took place in 36 days. The campaign in the West lasted 42 days. The campaign in Russia lasted 1,000 days. And there, the Germans discovered in the autumn of 1941 that the Blitz technique was failing precisely because of logistical problems that related to the German army as a whole, but it also related to the German tank columns. So logistics, I think, was the key problem with respect. It was a lesson the Germans learned in Poland It was a lesson they applied in France, by the way. They understood that air refueling of their armoured columns was important. There was also a kind of, always a kind of frisson de terreur in the German high command that somehow the panzers might run out of fuel, they might run out of ammunition, they might run out of, in other words, they might run out of ground. This is exactly what happened in Russia. And when that happened, then the Blitzkrieg floundered and flopped.
Audacious though he undoubtedly was, Hitler balked at the thought of his precious armored units racing too far or too deep into the Soviet hinterland, and settled instead for a compromise with the more traditional grand strategy of envelopment. By the end of June, Guderian and Hoth's tanks had joined near Minsk to complete a huge encirclement, and by mid-August, Army Group North was approaching Leningrad. The Germans continued to achieve extraordinary success, and the Wehrmacht surged on with undiminished impetus. Incredible numbers of prisoners were taken, and huge quantities of tanks and guns captured or destroyed. Despite this sustained progress, Guderian was increasingly conscious of grounds for unease in the development of the campaign. The unending immensity of the land depressed many soldiers. Lack of mobility, particularly of tracked vehicles, was a severe drawback. There continued to be a huge haul of prisoners, but the German pincers were closing too slowly, allowing large numbers of Red Army troops to get away, and the Red Army appeared to command endless reserves. Most roads were of dirt, which, with the sudden rains, turned quickly to mud, halting entire columns. Meanwhile, Hitler was vacillating. Having failed to annihilate the Red Army, his interest turned towards securing the economic prize of the Ukrainian oil wells. To Guderian's dismay, he was diverted from his plan to drive hard and fast for Moscow, whose fall into enemy hands would be a profound psychological shock for the Russians, and ordered south to the Ukraine. His divisions performed outstandingly, helping to take well over 500,000 prisoners and nearly 1,000 tanks. The advance to Moscow was resumed at the end of September, but the delay proved to be fatal. Fuel and supplies were delivered through a system that had become frequently inefficient, if not corrupt, and the lines of communication were enormously overextended. Shortages of every kind impaired the fighting ability of the frontline forces. The vague fears of the generals who had initially harbored doubts were beginning to take the shape of a massive problem. The advance had been over areas so vast that it was impossible for comprehensive mopping up operations to be undertaken. Behind the Germans, there lay the huge expanses of territory in which tens of thousands of Red Army troops roamed uncaptured.
The Blitzkrieg was a very limited technique, and it could not be universally or permanently applied. And when the Blitzkrieg, in a sense, ran out of steam, ran out of capability, then I think Hitler and the German command faced very serious problems.
Blitzkrieg's lifeblood was rapid movement, and the spearheads were now being reduced to a perilously slow crawl. The autumn rains were heavy. In France, there had been metalled roads. Here, the highways were vanishing into impassable tracts of mud in which men, vehicles, and horses floundered more and more helplessly. Breakdowns increased, and repairs became extremely difficult to carry out. Guderian had started Barbarossa with 600 tanks. By the middle of November, he was left with just 50 that were operational. With the first frosts came a cruelly short respite. The temperature continued to fall, and the soldiers now paid dearly for the arrogance that had refused to admit the possibility of anything other than a quick, decisive campaign. Few men had more than summer clothing, and frostbite took an agonizing toll. The Germans' machinery and guns had never been designed to function in such extremes. Engines seized up, tank tracks split asunder, ammunition would not fire. The fierceness of the cold was far beyond the experience of most Germans, but with incredible exertions they crept forward. It was a forlorn attempt, for by December, the advance had ground irretrievably to a halt. Forward units glimpsed the domes of the Kremlin in the distance. It may just as well have been 1,000 miles away. The mighty offensive in Russia had run its course. German armored divisions lay shattered in the frozen wastes before Moscow, together with Hitler's dreams of glory. The golden days of Blitzkrieg were at an end. An angry Hitler proclaimed himself supreme commander and dismissed many of his highest generals. On Christmas Day, 1941, Heinz Guderian was relieved of his command. A shameful way to treat such a committed soldier. As with so many aspects of Germany's war effort, Blitzkrieg was ahead of its time, revolutionary in its execution. It had contained the potential to bring Hitler the rewards he so ravenously sought. Blitzkrieg. The term will always be synonymous with fear and instant destruction. It conjures up the terrifying images of howling Stukas, thundering tanks, and the victorious advance of the swastika. Although the unparalleled success that it achieved early in the war was finally thrown away, in its time, Blitzkrieg was at the forefront of innovative warfare, and for that reason, its place in the history books is rightfully assured.